Tractate Teruvin, page 32. We continue our discussion of yesterday in regard to Shaliach, the emissary. There is a disputation between two rabbis. One is named Rav Nachman and the other one is Rav Sheshet. Rav Nachman said that we have to differentiate between rabbinic and a biblical precept. So let's, for those who just attend, let's go over what we discussed yesterday at the very end of our session. You ask someone else to do something on your behalf. In our discussion is a roof. You go to 2,000 cubits from your place and you place an a roof. It can apply also to other matters. Anybody have an example of something that you ask someone else to do it on your behalf? No? Gil, what do you think?
Yes, sometimes you ask somebody to do something and...
For example, let's talk halakha. Can a person ask someone to divorce his wife? In other words, he doesn't want to see her and he just wants to give the person the get and let him present it to her. Is that possible? Definitely yes,
yes,
with condition that
yes.
You have two witnesses and it's approved by the rabbinic
yes.
court. But the point is, that person, let's call him Reuven, he appointed Shimon to go together with Levi and Yehuda and present him to the get, the document to divorce. That's not only apply in that manner, it apply in many areas. So Rav Nachman come and said, we have to differentiate when we trusted other people and we ask about the reliability of those people. We have a discussion over people who are deaf mute, who are people who are not in a mental state, a minor that is not yet bar mitzvah. It's those people can you trust, or people who really denigrate, not believe in the Eruv. And we explain that we have issues and to trust these people, and therefore we basically do not trust them. But there are very situations, many, many situations, that it's like a gray area. Such as Rav Nachman said, when it's come to a biblical precept, you send your friend to do it, you send someone, and that person is familiar with the Torah law, that person usually followed. Rabbinic, you have to know who is that person. Rav Sheshet came and said, Echad ze ve'echad ze chazaka, shaliach oseh shlichuto. Rav Sheshet said, regardless if it's a biblical law or it's a rabbinic decree, we trust it. So Tosfot tells us here, that when it's come to involve with violation of laws, in other words, Reuven asked Shimon to go and make the Eruv for him. He gave him the two meals. You remember we discussed the two meals?
Yeah.
He gives him the two meals and he said, go there and place the Eruv over there. So he said, if it was involved in just doing a mitzvah, for example, Reuven wanted to go to a house of mourners on Saturday, on Shabbat, and visit there. So it's involved in procedure of mitzvah, but it's not violation of Torah laws. So we can depend on Shimon to go ahead and do that. But if it's an issue that if Shimon does something for Reuven, and if he doesn't do it right, or he doesn't do it properly, or he doesn't do it at all in any way, Reuven is involved with violation, then it's different story. You cannot depend on that fellow. The Rambam hold that according to Rav Sheshet, you can be lenient when it's come to the Torah laws, because usually you have this presumption that he will do that on your behalf properly, even the place that if he doesn't do it properly, the one who sent this emissary will turn to violation. Now, here we bring a source. We are page 32, and we are three lines from the top of the page. Amar Rav Sheshet, mena aminala. How do I prove that even when it's come to a Torah law, we can count on Shimon, on that emissary? Ditnan, there is a Mishnah in Tractate Benachot, page 68a. Mishekarav ha'omer hutar hechadash miyad. The Torah tells us in the book of Vayikra, Leviticus, Parashat Emor, velechem vekali vecharmel. There is a all this list of bread and different grain. It's considering tvuah hadasha. It's a new. So you have to wait until day after Passover in order to bring the Omer. As you know, now we are in an era at a time that we count the Omer every day. So that was a offering, public offering, that came out of that grain. And the time that it was brought to the temple was 16th day of the month of Nisan, which was the second day of Passover, and all that day was good to bring it as a sacrificial offering. At the era of the Beit HaMikdash, the temple, it was a prohibition to eat from any new product of the five species of grain until after they brought the Omer offering. Today, we do not have this offering of the Omer, and therefore the prohibition of eating something new, it's called Isur Chadash, it's up to the eve of 17th of Nisan in Eretz Israel, and in diaspora like here, it goes another day until the 18th day of month of Nisan, and that's Shulchan Or HaChaim 489. So he said, "Mi shekarav haomer, once the omer has been offered, the grain from utar echadash miyad, from the new crop, is immediately permitted." So since it was a time period, so that's the time allowed to. How about people who are distant from Yerushalayim, from Jerusalem? והרחוקים מותרים מחצות היום ואילך. They allowed to do it from the mid of the day of 16 and forward. So Rashi tells us here that the one who's our emissaries are the Kohanim. Now he go deeper in the Mishnah and he said, והחדש דאורייתא הוא. This is a Torah law to eat a new grain before bringing the Omer offering. Vekatanei, and we learn in the Mishnah, harechokim mutarim mechatzot hayom va'elach, that those who are far away or distance from Yerushalayim, they can go ahead and eat a new one, a new product of grain, from the middle of the day of 16 and onward. Lav mishum chazaka shaliach oseh shlichuto. Isn't that because those who are distant allowed to use this chadash from the middle of the day and onward, because we depend on this presumption, which means that we have the assumption, as Rashi tells us, that the Kohen is our emissary, and he needs to bring this offering for the public. So we have the assumption that he did his job before the middle of the day, which means we derive from that that even when it's come to Torah law, we can count on the emissary that do the job, that the presumption that the emissary do the job. Now, there are some Rishonim that asked that the truth of the matter, those Kohanim needs to do it regardless. Because there is a mitzvah in the Torah that you have to bring the Omer on the time. So there is a explanation, the Tosfot here, and the Ritva and the Rashba. He said the whole idea is, since you have time to do it all day, not in initio but by force of circumstance, therefore you can count on that statement. Rav Nachman, and the Gemara explained according to Rav Nachman that what did he say? You remember what Rav Nachman said, that we cannot count on the emissary to do properly his shlichut, his mission in regards to a Torah law. He rejected what Rav Sheshet said and said as follow: Hatam, in regard to the Omer offering, those people who are far away from Yerushalayim, from Jerusalem, they can depend on the fact that usually they make an arduous effort to bring this Omer offering before the middle of the day. Kidiktane tama, because they knew Shlefishiodin She'en Bedin Mitatzlin Bo, because they knew that the people who are in the rabbinic court, people who are in a Bet Din, they'll not act as a lazy, as indolent. Unfortunately, you see sometimes these people behavior, they're lazy and they count on the others to do the job for them. And they figure out, that job will be done regardless. Examples? There are people who attend services 10, 30, 25 minutes earlier and do what's needed in preparation for the service. There are people, no matter what, they're late. Only if they have their own yahrzeit, then they come on time. How come they late? Because they figured out the minyan will start anyway. The davening will start anyway. So, what's the big deal for me to be earlier? It's just human behavior. Not everyone has the perseverance and the sincerity to go and do these things properly. So, because there are people, especially people who live from distance, they figure out that they do that anyway. And therefore, we know that the Bet Din will go after the Kohanim. Even the Kohanim usually are quick, but they go after them to make sure that they do it before the midday. However, in our case, when you have just a regular emissary, that he is going independently and is not depend upon what the Bet Din require him or instructed him to do it, so when it's come to Torah law, you cannot depend on that emissary. So again, we have to differentiate between people on mission and they have a supervisor to make sure that they're doing it properly, and people who are independent. And when you have independent contractor, you know, those who are involved in constructions, they know it well. That when you have a company and you have employee that does the job, so they know you don't do the job, you don't get paid, or you don't get paid properly if you don't follow the contract. If you have independent contractor that have five other jobs at the same times, so maybe he come, maybe he's not coming, maybe he doesn't. That's the way some people behave. So therefore, a independent shaliach, emissary, that did not work on behalf of the Bet Din, when it's come to Torah law, you cannot depend on him. Ve'ika de'amri is another option. How do we learn from the Mishnah in Menachot? Amar Rav Nachman mena amin ala. How do I know that when it's come to Torah law, we not depend on the shaliach? Ve'ktanei tama. Because we learn in the Mishnah the reason. לפי שיודעים שאין בדין מתעצלים בו. Because we know that the bedding go after this Kohanim. Bedding, who the law mitatzlin bo? Hashaliach mitatzel bo. Again, independent person, it's a different story. He may be lazy, tomorrow, manana, right?
Mm-hmm.
Etc. So, when it's come to that, it's a different story. So, Rav Sheshet here have an issue of counting on this guy. And it's applied in many, many areas. I talked recently with one of my colleagues. He is a rabbi that in charge for the kashrut in many places. It's like kashrut supervision. So I said to him, I never like in my 20 years in rabbinate, never like to deal with big organization kashrut. I said, why? He said, because you depend on people. And if people, you send them to do something and you train them, and if you are not physically there in all those places, how you will be able to give your responsibility, your words, that it's going to function well? You have the training people and you come sometimes to supervise them, but you cannot, especially if you're dealing with large organization, it's difficult, it's almost impossible to go and watch each and everyone if they do their mission properly. So you're basically counting on people. So counting on people, here Rav Sheshet have the issue when it's come to Torah law to count on independent contractor, independent person. V'Rav Sheshet, and here Rav Sheshet respond. And he said, Amar lach, what he rejected what Rav Nachman said. He said, Bet Din, because the rabbinic court, they are very scrupulous, they are very strict, they're not lazy, they go after that person and they make sure that he does his job properly. We apply to Ad Palge de Yoma, as we explained, to bring the Omer offering until the middle of the day. So, even though, as we said, but the avad by force of circumstance, you can bring the Omer offering all day, but you know that the Bet Din will make sure to do it before the middle day. Shaliach, kuleyama, a regular person, he wait all day, so you cannot count on him. But if at the end of the day, when his mission is, you know, he has to fulfill mission at the end of the day, so you can depend on that shaliach that he will do his job even in the Torah law. Because even that guy knew that there is a time limitation and he cannot exceed it more than the end of that day. So therefore he said, you can count on him. Count on him to do it before middle of the day? Question mark. Count him to do the job? Yes. Do you ever have employees? Anyone has an employee that tells you, okay, I'll do the job, but don't push me. I'll do it. When I have the moment, I'll do it. And you know, the problem you have is that person will do a very good job, but you cannot be officious. You know, he's officious. Officious is a person who go after the employee, tell him what to do, watch him doing it, corrected him how he does that, and then criticize the way that he does that. You know, that's officious person. So he tells you, I got the point, let me do it in my time. So it means that that emissary will do it, but maybe not in the way that we wish lechatchila, in initio, the way that we wanted to do it in the middle of the day, but he can do it for sure before the end of the day. And therefore, Rav Sheshet said, if it's come to Torah law, you can count on him. It's not the best way, but you can count on him. He bring another proof. Amar Rav Sheshet mena minala. How do you know that even when it's come to Torah law, you can count on that emissary? The Tanya. We learn it in a brighter. Ha'isha sheyesh aleha leida, o ziva, מביאה מעות ונותנת בשופר, וטובלת ואוכלת בקודשים לערב. The Torah tells us when a woman gave birth, she needs to bring an offering, a sacrificial offering. The Torah tells us 40 days after she have a baby boy, or 80 days after she have a baby girl, she needs to bring a goat offering, sheep offering, for a olah offering, and dove, or male dove, for a sin offering, and then she can go ahead and eat consecrated offering. If the Torah said she cannot afford it, so she bring two doves, one for olah offering, one for sin offering. So here we talk about poor lady. She delivered a baby, but she cannot afford much, so she come to the Beit HaMikdash, she come to the temple, and she have cash. And she said, take this cash, buy for me the two cheapest offering, can be two doves that they Beit HaMikdash, and they bring it on her behalf. We call it Kinei Yoledet. That's the offering that poor woman that deliver the baby can bring. You have to know also a little about the philosophy behind that. It's a life-threatening situation sometimes. And beside of the physical change of her body, it's something that she express her thankfulness for surviving and her and the baby, etc. So logically we understand the reason for that. But here we talk in a sense of Jewish law in halacha. And we said in a situation like that, so she go ahead and she bring this offering. Another option is when she have those discharge which we discussed, so she bring this money and she put it in the box. We call it shofar, because if you look at the shofar, you see that is a small entrance, and then if you look at the shofar, there is a large outside. So they made it in a temple because, like every other society, you have thieves that come and steal money from that public pushke, public money. So they made it a small hole so people cannot put their hands in and pull money outside. And it was the rabbis tells us it was 13 locations in Beit HaMikdash that women can do that, that they can put the money over there for that purpose. So then after she did that, and how she did that, she took the money, she put it in a little pocket, and she put it in. Why it's a little pocket? Any guess why it's a little pocket she did? Because she doesn't want to mix with other ladies. So in other words, the Kohen who in charge for that shift, opened the box. He now needs to take this money and buy offering for that poor delivered lady. He needs to know what type, because it's different prices, different quality, different. So if it's in a package, he know that this is for Mrs. A, and he take for Mrs. A, and he not mixes with Mrs. B. So she put it in a small pocket, she wrap it up, open that hole and put it in, but tight it in, and it's there. Now, Tosfot explain that one of the idea of offering, it's individual offering. So if you mix more than one person, you have issues, because it's no longer individual. That's the reason we have to do it in a certain procedure. After doing that, she can go ahead and duck herself in the mikveh, in a ritual bath, and she is now in a new status. The ritual bath is rabbinic. It's a Gemara tells us in the tractate Chagigah 21. They say that that's completion of the process, because up to that point they are forbidden. These people have this category to eat a consecrated food, and from that point they are ritually pure. So, and then my tama, you basically depend upon the Kohanim that does the job for you. Lav mishum de amrinan chazaka shaliach ose shlichuto, that you count that the emissary will do his job. So I see it's one guy walking, so let's make sure that everyone understands it. We have a discussion here over depending on other people. We want to make sure that our agent, we have the assumption that our agent will do his job properly. So far, so good? Clear?
Yeah.
We bring an example to prove that we can count on others from the issue of women that deliver a child. We explain that she needs to bring an offering, and in a circumstance that she's an example poor and she cannot bring physical offering, she wrap up her money in a small bag, she put it in a small hole, it's like shofar, and then the Kohen will take her, is a 13 locations in the Beit HaMikdash, and use that money to purchase the two doves. She can write a little note for him, for example, right? And he goes ahead and buy it and make the offering on her behalf. Okay? Now, this process will take place. Yet, the moment she put it in, she can go ahead and duck herself in a mikveh and eat a consecrated food. Now you ask a question, how do you know that the Kohen pull out the bag, open it, purchase something, and went ahead and bought the offering? We explain that we can count on the Kohen to do it. Okay? So we have the presumption, the idea that they're doing it proper. Now, remember, if they don't do that, it's a violation of Torah law. Torah law used the word karet, that soul should be cut off. It's very serious. So it means even this idea of eating consecrated food while you are not in a state of purity, you count on someone else. V'Rav Nachman, how Rav Nachman explained, this is a very serious proof, right? So Rav Nachman said, Hatam k'derav Shmaya. D'amar Rav Shmaya, chazaka, en bedin shel kohanim, omdim misham ad sheichlu kol mash'ot shebashofar. Which means, you have a court of the kohanim. And that court in the Beit HaMikdash, they are very strict. They go there to make sure that they do the job. So they want to make sure that all the Kohanim does the job properly. So they go around all these, remember we talk about 13 different locations, they go, they make sure that no one left with the finish the shift and is a packages in any place of people that wants to take the money and buy the offering and do the job. So therefore, they said, that's applied to a situation when you have a system and you have a rabbinic court and you have the supervisor and you know that they are doing it properly. But as individual, again, that you don't have the supervision of the Bet Din, you cannot depend when it's come to Torah law. Amar Rav Sheshet mena aminala. How do you know it? So he said it, Tanya. Here is an example. Ha'omer lechavero. Gilbert said to David, Tse velaket lecha te'enim mit'enati. You see outside of my yard, Gilbert said, this is my fig tree. Belongs to me. Go and collect some fig for me. Fine. Now, what's the issue? He doesn't say specifically what, how, what's the status, etc. Ochel mehem arai. ומאסרן ודאי. So it means if it's just temporary, he can pick up the figs and eat from them without taking tithe. But if he's planning to do it as a permanent meal, he needs to take a tithe in advance. Now, if it was a complete statement, then you remember we said that there's a several tithe for the Kohen, for the Levi, for the poor, remember all of that. But if it wasn't clear, so that's a different story. Why it's not clear? Because Gilbert disappeared now. And David is not sure if Gilbert put a tithe over that tree. Mm-hmm. Maybe he did, maybe not. So he figured out, so if it was just a temporary manner of eating, that's different. But if it's a different story, he's not so sure. So it's an issue. So, but here is a different story. But Maleya lecha kalkala ze te'anim mit'enati. But if he said to him, look, take this basket, David, and he said, filled up this basket for yourself with figs from my fig tree. So he said, Ochel men arayu me'asran d'mai, he may eat from them casually without tithing, and before eating them as a regular meal, he must tithe them as d'mai. Right? Because you don't know what exactly involved here. Because maybe he did it, maybe not. So, in other words, because he's not sure, David doesn't have the obligation to give a tithe to Levi, to the poor person, because there is a concept in Hilchot Mamonot, in money, Hamotzi mechavero alav araya. If you want to have another fellow give you money, for example, if Yosef wants to get the money from Edward, okay, and he claimed that Edward owed him money, the burden of proof is upon whom? Upon Yosef. Why? Because he wants money from Edward, so he need to prove that Edward owed him money. So in our case, since Gilbert asked David to take figs from his tree, so David, now Gilbert is not around, so David now, in one hand, can eat it. But David doesn't have the obligation to give a tithe for the Gilbert's tree. Why? Because maybe Gilbert did it, and the burden of proof is not upon David. Because basically it's not his. Maybe, for example, Gilbert owned another fig tree on the other side of this property, and he combined them both, he already gave tithe. Or maybe he gave tithe for that one. So since David doesn't know, he doesn't have the obligation to do it. He says, "Bamed dvarim amurim," when you have this issue of demai, you remember yesterday we explained demai, da, mai, this is what, you're not sure if the person who not educated put aside tithe. Be'am ha'aretz. That applies to a person who is not educated. What is not educated? So the idea is, we don't say that that person does that purposely. Mm-hmm. But it may turn, there is a concept in the Torah that's called, before a blind, don't place a stumble block before a blind person. So the thing is, Gilbert may be put an assumption that everything was tied already, or he has his own plan. But the big question is, if basically he asked David to do something, he doesn't specify if he put a stumbling block before David, mm-hmm. since he doesn't specify. So he said, that apply if that person is not educated. Aval chaver. Chaver in a Talmud, you remember when Clinton said to late Rabin, Shalom chaver? Chaver in a Talmud is a different concept. It's not just a regular friend. Chaver is a trustworthy fellow, God-fearing person. So it means when you have a community, you know this person is a very trustworthy. You can count on him blindly. Like in the, it used to be in a jewelry business, they shake hands, that's the deal. You give you a suitcase, they shake hand, that's the value of the suitcase of jewelry, pay the money, goodbye. Right? Mazal u'bracha. Shake hand, goodbye. So he said, that's applied to chaver, that you know that that person is a God-fearing person, is trustworthy, and you know that he tie from his food, and therefore it's different, it's chaver. And every Torah scholar and everyone in that category that accept upon himself chaverut, that is part of that group, we count on that. However, someone who's not member of the club, right? It's outside. So it's an issue. You cannot trust on him when it's come to tithing. And he is a produce, it's considering demai, which means you are in a doubt, in a dilemma, in predicament, if he tithed or not. Okay? And therefore, ochel ve'eno tzarich le'aser divrei rebi. If it's chaver, you can go ahead and eat. If Gilbert is a chaver, David can go ahead and eat it and doesn't need to bother to put a tie. Because why? Because Gilbert, even is not here, is a chaver. Clear? Mm-hmm. Now, Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel omer, b'me dvarim amurim be'am haaretz, aval b'chaver eno ochel ad she'yaser lefi shelo nechshedu chaverim litrom shelo min amukav. Because, as we said, that the people who are part of the God-fearing community are not suspected of separating truma and tithe from produce that is not adjunct to the produce they seek to exempt. Amar Rabbi, nir'im dvarai midivrei Abba. Since it's a son and a father, Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel was the father of the Rebbe, so he said, my statement appears to be more correct than my dad. Why? Mutav yechashdu chaverim litrom shelo mukav. It's better for chaverim should be suspected of separating truma and tithe from produce that is not adjunct to the produce that they seek to exempt. Velo yachilu le'amei haaretz tvalim, and will not feed those who are not educated produce that contain tevel. Tevel is a product that was not yet tied. So ad kan lo pligi. So Rav Sheshet understand as follows. These Tanaim disagree only. Ela demar, the Rebbe hold, savar necheshdu, umar savar loch necheshdu. Rebbe hold that we are suspected chaverim, that the tightening which produce that it's not adjunct to the produce that they come to exam, and the other one, Umar Savar and Rabban Shimon Gamliel hold, lo nechshedu, you don't suspect them. Aval, the owner of that fig tree, kule alma, everyone agreed, chazaka shaliach oseh shlichuto, have the presumption that an agent fulfilling his agency, which means that the owner who is regarded as an agent for his product, that no one will eat tevel on his account. So that we know that he separate the tithe. V'Rav Nachman, so how Rav Nachman respond? Hatam kidrav chanina choza, d'amar Rav chanina choza, chazaka u'al chaver, שאינו מוציא דבר שאינו מתוקן מתחת ידו. We have this חזקה, that's like legal presumption, that chaver, that a fellow God-fearing person, does not release anything that is not tied from his possession. So when it's come to that, you can count on him. So he said, "Amar mar b'me dvarim amurim b'am haaretz, aval b'chaver ochel v'no tzarich la'aser divrei Rebbe." So he said, "Hi, am haaretz, this owner of the fig is uneducated, but the kamar leleman." So it means to whom? What do we mean? Ilema de kamar la'am haaretz chavrei. That if an uneducated said to his fellow, "Me'asran d'mai," so that compared to someone who's tightening the mai, mitzayit. Someone who's not educated will not trust another uneducated person. So, in other words, I'm sorry, someone who's uneducated, if it's his body, he trusted his body, because in his mind is a loyal friend. So he trusted the other fellow that he tightened this fig, and he will not put it tight because we are not so sure. Ela be'amar es dekamar lechaver. So they have to be in an uneducated person that said to the chaver, "Eima seifa nir'im dvarai midivrei abba, mutav shechishidu chaverim litrom, shlom nokav alechul ha'amar es tvalim." So it's better that we suspected for chaverim should be suspected of separating truma from tithe from produce, that to the produce that may be seek to exempt, and they should not feed people on uneducated with tevel. So he said, "Ame aretz mai bayata." So why we put what's the relevant of the people of not educated to hear? The situation is opposite. The person eating the fig is a chaver, and the owner of the fig is not educated. Amar Ravina, Reisha, the first clause of the Braita, be'amar et shamar lechaver, that uneducated said to a chaver, seifa bechaver shamar lamaretz, וחבר אחר שומו, but is another fellow heard the conversation, and that's the explanation of the discussion. Rabbi, which Rabbi Yehuda Hanasii, 32b, סבר, אותו חבר אוכל ואינו צריך לעשר. דוודאי איסו ומעשר, הוא חבר כמה ילווה. Says that fellow can eat the fig, and he doesn't need to take it tight. Why? Because we have the assumption that he is not required to tie the produce, as the first chaver certainly separated tied for the person who picked the figs. So we have the assumption that he is not going to make a uneducated person to eat tevel. Rabban Shimon Gamliel omer lo yochal ad she'aser. The second chaver will not eat until he tightened that fig. Lefishen no nechshedu chaverim litrom shelo min amukaf, even for the sake of uneducated person, you don't suspect that chaverim they are not tightening from that. Ve'amar lei Rabbi said to Rabban Shimon Gamliel, mutav, it's better sheyachshedu chaverim litrom shelo min amukaf ve'lechu la'aretz tvalim. The same point. So it's all apply that if uneducated, if Am Haaretz said to the chaver to do it, but if the chaver said to Am Haaretz, different, and the other chaver can eat and doesn't need to tie. So again, depend how you count. If it's chaver, you count on him. If it's Am Haaretz, it's a different story. B'maika miflegei, what's the really the principle that disagree? Rabbi sabar nichal el dechaver la'aveh u'lisur haklila, which means he hold that it's better for chaver to violate a light prohibition, because they said if it's not min amukaf, it's a light violation. Velo le'avad amaretz esur haraba, but not to carry the prohibition of eating tevel for am haaretz, for an uneducated. Rabban Shimon gamliel sevar nicha lechaver levar amaretz esur haraba, that opposite ve'iru afilu sir klil la'avdei. So he said the opposite, that it's preferable for the chaver that in Am Haaretz commit a major transgression, and he himself not commit even a minor transgression. So again, it's a different perception what's involved here. Rabban Shimon Gamliel hold that you don't ask a chaver even to have a light violation in order to save Am Haaretz from a severe violation, because the chaver is not hold responsibility for having the Am Haaretz eating tevel. Anyway, for more in that, there is a lot to explain here, Tosfot here and many more, but I wish to have more time. I get the signals, it's okay. Let's go to the Mishnah. Before we go to that Mishnah, just introduction. When it's come to Eruvei Tchumim, what is Eruvei Tchumim? You place one location that you're planning to dwell, let's say you're planning to be in Edgewater, in this property, in this house for Shabbat. 2,000 cubit, you place the two meals. So you have a clear location over there, over there. What happens if you have an issue to use that location? Meaning, for example, you not intend to be there, to stay there or to be there. Just place it over there. So the issue is, if the owner cannot go before the twilight and use it, is an issue. Here you see a clear example. Netano be'ilan lemala ma'asarat fachim. Imagine a fellow wants to take an eruv, so he doesn't want to put it on the middle of the road. So how he take this bag with the two meals, and he see a tree, and the tree is highest than 10 hand breadth, okay? So he climb over the tree, he hang the bag, and he put it there. Okay, and that's his eruv. So they said, en eruvo eruv. You remember what we said, that you cannot climb over the tree on Shabbat, right, and do things, because it's all issue of a cutting on the branches, etc. So, therefore, it's not considering your eruv because you cannot pick it up. And if you need to pick it up, you are in violation. However, lemata ma'asarat fachim, if it's below than 10 hand breadth, which means average person can go and reach it and pick it up. Eruv, eruv, that's fine, it's considering an eruv. Now, we talk heights, now let's talk below. Netano bebo, if you put it in the pit, which means you take the 2 mil of the eruv and you put it in a pit, afilu amok me'a ama eruvo eruv. Even, we use the language of exaggeration, even they have 100 cubits deep, his eruv is considering a valid eruv. Now we elaborate. Yativ Rabbi Chiya bar Abba v'Rabbi Asi v'Rava bar Natan v'yativ Rav Nachman Gabayu v'yat v'karam reitz. A group of sages get together. Hai ilan dekaye echa. What exactly tree we have in our discussion here? I leima dekaye birshut harabim. If you tell me that tree is in a private domain, mali lemala, mali lemada. What's the difference if it's above 10 hand breadth or below? Reshut hayachid ola ad larakia. You remember what we said? That public domain, you can go by the 10 hand breadth, and that's it. Mm-hmm. Private domain, we said, you have the ownership up to heaven, which means, for example, when you have a building permit, so if you have a building permit in as a private domain, so you own the property up to the highest sky, it's you. If it's a public domain, it's up to 10 hand breadth. We explained in the Tractate Shabbat, page 7, if you remember. So he said here, if that tree is in your domain, in your property, it's 2,000 amah from the your location, but you own that place, so what's the difference between 10 hand breadth or below or above? Ve'elad de kai birshut harabim. You have to tell me that tree 2,000 cubits from the place that you're dwelling from Edgewater is in the public domain. Now, here is the issue. The mitkaven lishbot heicha. Where exactly the owner of that eruv planning to dwell on Shabbat? Ileima. The mitkaven lishbot milamala, that he has in his intent before Shabbat to dwell and rest up in a tree. Hu ve'eruvo b'makom echadu. He and his eruv is in one location. So, therefore, why you tell me that it's not considering an eruv? It was, that's what his intent to be there. Elak shnitkaven lishbot lemata, which means he intend to be below, like he planning to sit in a shed, for example, below the tree and eat it. So what happened now? He is basically goes and placing something that it's that it will be above the place that he will dwell. You see in the picture 161 in the Me'orot Adaf, this is the tree, this is the 10 hand bread. He put the food here. So if he intend to come on Shabbat and sit here and eat it, it's one thing. But if he intend to sit here and eat it, and the food was placed above that, then we have an issue. Is that clear?
Yes.
So they said, V'ha kamishtamesh ba'ilan, but he is using the tree, and the sages not allowed to use tree on Shabbat. So the Gemara respond, Le'olam deka'e bershut harabim, that the tree is standing in the public domain. V'nitkaven lishbot lemata, that he planning to dwell below than that tree. V'rabi hi de'amar, that's according to Rabbi who said, כל דבר שהוא משום שבות לא גזרו עליו בין השמשות. Rabbi said that anything that is prohibited on Shabbat, not by Torah law, but because of rabbinic decree, it's called שבות, the sages did not issue the decree to apply during twilight. Because twilight is not clear. It's not day, not night. It's in between. So it may be Shabbat, it may be a secular day. So therefore, he and his Eruv is in one location, and his Eruv is considering an Eruv. Amar lo Rav Nachman, Yishar. He said, what you said is well said. וכן אמר שמואל, and also שמואל said in interpretation of the Mishnah, some said, he also said, well said, אמרו לי, פטריטו בא כולי היי, that's the way you solve the Mishnah, אינהו נמי החי כפטרי בא, we, or they in a sense, explaining the Mishnah as follows, Amrulei, or Elahache Amrulei. That's the way they explain. Kav'itu lei bigmara. This is the way that established an explanation as part of your regular study in a Mishnah. So it means that that's the way you interpret it for the future generation. Amar lehu ein. He said to them, yes. Indeed, itmar namei. אמר רב נחמן, אמר שמואל, אח הבילן, אומר ברשות הרבים מסכינן, we are in a tree that is in a public domain, גבוה 10 ורחב 4, is a 10 hand breadth high, and 4 hand breadth wide, ונתכוון לשבות למטה, and he planning to dwell below than the tree, ורבי ידע אמר, כל דבר שהוא משום שבות לא גזרו עליו בין השמשות, and רבי said, that anything that prohibited by Shabbat, not by Torah law, but rather by the rabbinic decree, the sages not issued decree, applied during the twilight. And now we elaborate on the Mishnah. Amar Rava, Rava explained, Lo shanu ela bilana omer chutz libura shel ir. That's applied to a tree that it's beyond the outskirts of the city, which means outside of the radius of 70 and 2/3 cubit around the city. Aval ilana omed betoch hibura shel ir. But even that it's a tree that is within we part of Eruvei Tchumim inside the city, afilu lemala ma'asara harei ze eruv, even above the 10 enbret is considering eruv. Why? Because in Eruvei Tchumim we said demata keman demalia dama, because as the city is considered as though it were filled in with earth. So anything that is located at any height, the outskirts of town, regarded as being the same domain. So it means that his dwelling and the eruv, it's all in one location. Ihachei chutz liibura shel ir nami. So if that's the case, if the tree stood beyond the outskirts of the town, it should also. So they said, Kevan de Amar Rabba hanoten eruvo yesh lo arba amot, havya la reshut hayachid, ureshut hayachid ola ad larakia. So Rashi here used the word klomar. I explained it in my book, Birurei HaKlomar Berashi al Hashas. He said that, ba'ay pirka gaben gargel chus latchum dektanim batnitin eno eruv, ואמר רבא לא שמור של גדל חוץ לתחום 400, אבל בתוך 400 נותן לרובו יש לו 400, כלומר 400 סבו עבו למקף מוחצות. So it means that we originally considering this as closed location, but here, because the partition go up to Rakia, up to heaven, is no limitation, so Rashi here elaborate in the כלומר and explain what's the difference, but I see your signals so running out of time, so can read it in a book. But anyway, Amar Rav Misharsha, just let's finish it. Amar Rav Yitzchak Bremer de Rav Misharsha, Acha Bila Noten Chutz L'Arba'amot Askinan. Here we talk about the tree that it's outside of the four cubit, and therefore page 33a, V'nitkaven Lishbot Be'ikaro, and he intended to establish his Shabbat residence at its base. ומאי למעלה ומאי למטה, and what is the meaning of the term above and below? The hadar zakif, it means it rises once again in an upright position, and therefore the term above and below are applicable. So he said uveha ibaye maita la derech alav. Isn't that true that even the eruv is above the 10 handbreadth? If one wants, he can remove it from there and deposit it, bring it way to the tree leaves, which means its branch. So he said, כשרבים מחטפים עליו וכדאו לה, it dealing with a situation that where the horizontal section of the tree, it's used the masses to shoulder it and the burden of it, which means that it's a temporary rest and it's load on it. דאמר אולה עמוד תשעה, ברשות הרבים, ורבים מחטפים עליו, זרק ונח על גביו, חייב. So, in the book, מאורות, he explained. So, he said, picture number 162, he said, this is the four cubit, a place that he dwell, that's the place that it's changed. And here, we explained that this is the size of the ten, and this is the private domain. So again, tomorrow in Mitzvah Shem we go and explain what's involved here. But just let's finish. Zarak v'nachal al gabav chayav, and now we're going to a practical halachot. Ramba milchot trumot chezkat shaliach. Although some authority relied on the rule of the Gaonim, that the presumption with regard to an agent, we ask a question that the difference between Torah law and rabbinic law, if you can depend on an agent. So he said that the Torah law, we are not lenient, and we do not rely on the basis of presumption that an agent fulfills his mission. Rabbinic law is a different story. We also talk about Chadash. Once the Omer sacrifice has been offered, the new crop of grain may be eaten. People who live from far from Jerusalem may partake of the new grain from midday onward. But after the destruction of the temple, the new crop of grain is forbidden until after the 16th day of the month of Nisan. We talk about a woman that delivered a child, a baby, and we brought the Rambam, who said in the Sefer Korbanot, chapter 1, Ilchot Mechusar Kapara, chapter 1, a woman followed childbirth, and the Zava will bring money to the Beit HaMikdash, a temple, and place it on the designated box. Remember we said about 13 boxes?
Yeah.
And after immersing, that woman is permitted to go and eat a sacred food at nightfall, since their purification sacrifice were certainly offered by them. You see the difference between the time that we depend on a Beit Din that go after the Kohanim to make sure that they do it, versus at the end of the day when it's for sure done. If one person said to another, take figs for yourself from my fig tree, you remember that? And yes. He specified a particular amount. The presumption is that the owner must certainly tithe the fruit. However, if he did not specify, then the recipient might separate tithe. It's apply when it's an uneducated Am Haaretz makes an offer to a chaver, to a God-fearing person. However, if the chaver offers the fig to an Am Haaretz, and a different chaver who heard this statement wants to eat from the figs, he needs not tie the fruit as demai, because you can trust it, it's a God-fearing person. We also discussed the situation that one put an eruv on in a tree. And this is Shulchan Aruch HaChaim 409. If one placed an eruv, his eruv in a tree or in a pit, such that eruv, the eruv is a different domain than the one in which is established in Shabbat residence, and he is prohibited to carry the eruv to his Shabbat resident, the eruv is not valid. However, if one placed an eruv in a location from which it is prohibited to carry only by rabbinic decree, the eruv is valid. That's we said at the statement of Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi'. Shvut ben Ashmashot, Shulchan Aruch HaChaim 307, an act prohibited by rabbinic decree, it's called Shvut. It's not prohibited during the twilight period of on Friday, provided that it's performed for the purpose of a mitzvah. The last halacha, we talk about ilan bi'ibura shel, betoch ibura shel ir. Shulchan Aruch HaChaim 307. The halacha does not accept the Rava's distinction between the tree standing within the boundary of the town and one standing outside of the boundary of the town. So therefore, a tree stands the outskirts of the city. In that sense, it carry the same halacha. And tomorrow, Meretz Hashem, we're going to talk about a pillar that have 9 handbreadth height in a public domain. And also, we're going to speak about the different size of the public domain and private domain when it's come to a eruv on those trees. Shut up.